welcome. Tell us where you were born, your early life, and parents and siblings. Tell us a little bit about your early life and where you went to school.
Well, I was born in 1947 in East Chicago, Indiana, which is about 30 miles east of Chicago. I went to Eugene Field School for elementary school, and back then we didn't have middle school, so I went straight to Washington High School, home of the very famous back then Washington Senators, which was a very, very strong basketball team that used to come down to Purdue and then to Indianapolis for the state finals, often under Coach Johnny Beretta. Some people will remember him because back in those days he was very popular. I graduated from high school in 1965, and I applied to several colleges. Actually, I literally lived across on the other side of the tracks, and so as I got older, I used to get more involved in high school, and I followed around those students that seemed to be quite successful. So whatever the really successful, popular students did. They applied to college, I applied to college. I guess before I say that, I have to say that my parents and my little brother all died by the time I was 11 years old. So I was really raised by extended family. And during those last 3 years of my high school years, my grandfather, my uncle, and my uncle's two little boys and myself were the people that lived in our home. So I played all of the female roles there. But I also tried to keep up with what was going on in school and be involved with things. So anyway, I applied to these different colleges, and I would tell them about, you'd have to write essays, and I'd tell them about my background, and they'd tell me that people with backgrounds such as mine probably wouldn't be successful. But there was a high school assistant principal whose daughter came to Purdue University, and he insisted that this is where I needed to be. I'd come down here once during one of the semi-state basketball things, and I could have sworn I was in Mississippi. I'd never seen anything like this in Indiana before, living so close to Chicago and right there by Inland Steel and, you know, those kinds of things. Coming down here and seeing all of the farms, and it was a real different experience. And I know that every summer we used to get trekked to Mississippi and spend the entire summer on a farm in Mississippi doing what I call, quote-unquote, hard labor. But we had good food, and we had great water, and we had fun. Anyway, I just knew I didn't want to come here, but I ended up getting admitted to Purdue, and so I came here. And that's the beginning of my experience at Purdue, which started in the fall of 1965. I was probably one of about 20, back then it was called, we were called Negroes, or Coloreds, or the other famous N-word, and I was about one of 20 female African Americans out of what we all guesstimated or were told were a total of 100 African Americans on campus at that time, most of which were football or basketball players or majoring in engineering or pharmacy. And believe it or not, I actually had a great time. Being in such short demand, females, I was able to have several dates in one evening, so it was just fun. I didn't know any better, so I'd go on a date with one guy, and I'd say, I have to get back, though, because I have another date. I thought it was okay to do that. Somebody finally told me, you're not supposed to do that. That's just not nice. So
coming back, back a little bit to the high school, when you were in high school, were there any activities that you were pretty much, what about athletics, anything of that?
I belonged to something that was called the Top 20. We had this dance troupe that one of our gym teachers, who was a modern dance instructor, started there. It was extremely famous, and it was really difficult to get into. And this teacher gave me an opportunity. It was only 20 of us allowed in it. We would work out after school, and we actually did halftime performances at the games. And we were all
sport events? At sport events, games?
And not only that, but also at, we would also do performances at what, convocations or what have you, and we were often invited to do things out in the community. So it was really a character building experience for me. I think I was given the opportunity primarily because it was shortly after my grandmother had died, and she had come to help raise me after my mother died, and then she died, so my grandfather came, and then here comes my uncle and his two little boys, and so I think, you know, she's decided that I needed to have some other kinds of experiences besides those. And it was really a good experience for me. Very, very good. It was a very popular organization back then.
Yeah.
Now, that school doesn't exist anymore because there were two schools in East Chicago. One on the Calumet side and one on the East Chicago side, which was called the Harbor. So I lived in the Harbor, and that's where Washington High School was. And what, probably about 25, 30 years ago, the two schools merged, and it's called Washington Central now, or East Chicago Central, that's what it's called.
Okay.
So I don't know anything about it.
Okay. Now that brings us to, you lived on campus. What was the campus like, and did you live in a dorm? And
Yes, I lived in Warren Hall, and in my particular, it was all girls, obviously, back then. Back then, we had, manners and values and all kinds of things, because on certain days you all had to come to dinner at the same time and have a prayer and sit down and the food would be served and those different kinds of things. So in the male dorms, they had to wear a shirt and tie every day to go to meals. So that was good. But I lived in Warren Hall, and there were two other black girls that live in Warren Hall.
Uh-huh.
And I had white roommates. The room was extremely small. We had one little small closet. She had a lot of clothes. I didn't. So there were some problems at the beginning because this girl and her family really didn't want to have this kind of arrangement going on. So she was eventually moved. And that was great. I had a room by myself for a little while. And then I got another roommate the second year, and we became fast friends. In fact, she came by my office about 5 years ago to visit me, and I was just shocked because I had not heard from her, seen her in ages. So yeah, I lived in Warren Hall for those first couple of years. We had hours. The girls did, the guys didn't. And so you would see cars lined up down 3rd Street all the way to university, with girls jumping out of a fly and trying to get into that dorm before closing hours. So that was interesting. I remember my freshman year when we had to wear the beanies, the green beanies, that freshman year. And then I remember when guys would come and do those serenades under the windows to the girls, and girls would throw their panties out. That was not black girls, okay. That's what used to happen. Those were interesting times.
Yeah.
So
did you live in that dorm the whole time then?
No, I moved out, I believe it was my junior year.
Okay.
I moved out.
Did you live in the community then, or did you get an apartment?
Yeah, I lived in apartments. Myself and a couple of other girls, we got together. Joined a sorority. As a matter of fact, was one of the founding members of the chapter here at Purdue called Zeta Theta, of Delta Sigma Theta sorority. So as a consequence, you know, we had really close relationships.
Sure.
And stuff. In fact, all of the black students on this campus, those first 3 years, had extremely close relationships because we would go to all of our classes and be the only one in it. Until about my senior year, I'd start getting, junior, senior year, there might be one or two others in, and it would be mostly in elective-type courses that we'd have to take to fulfill all of our hour requirements. And so, you know, recreational classes, obviously you're going to get some of the athletes in there who used to really burn me up because they'd do nothing and they'd still get the grades.
What was your major?
I majored in sociology.
Okay.
And a minor in psychology.
Yeah.
And graduated in 4 years of that.
That's good. What did you do? Were you here during the summer at all, or did you go home during the summer?
No, I tried to be here most of the summer. In fact, I used to be one of the first ones, last ones to leave for breaks and the first ones back. I mean, when I went home, it was, you know, you had to get back to playing the role of big sister, cousin, niece, grandchild, cook, cleaner, you know, the whole bit. And then the other thing is, when you're raised by an extended family, I had lots of aunts and uncles, and you go home, if you don't go and see everybody, you catch hell for it. And so, you know, you just try to stay away as much as possible. Besides, once I got used to the environment here, I really, really had fun because, like I said, because there were so few of us, we were forced to bond together.
Mm-hmm.
And we made really close relationships that have been lifelong.
You still keep in touch?
A number of us do. In fact, right. Leroy Keith was in my freshman class. Ralph Taylor, who played basketball. Leroy, obviously, you know, played football. Marion Griffin. What's his name? Williams, I can't remember. Herman Gilliam, he was my first boyfriend. He was on the basketball team. Those.
What were some of the activities? Did they have dances in the union? Was the union used?
That was interesting, too. Now, that was really interesting. We tried to go to, they used to have this thing called computer dances, and we decided we were going to try to all go to the computer
dances.
You'd fill out these, back in the day, you know, they had those debit cards for computers, and you'd fill out this thing that, it was sort of like modern-day dating, match-type things. Fill out the computer thing, turn it in, they run it, you go to the computer dance, and that's where you found out who you were matched up with. Well, that didn't go over real well with the other people. A couple of the students got matched with white students, and that just was like not a good thing. So we decided in order not to make life too stressful for us, we ought not to be continuing to try to do these things, because we did try initially to get involved with the university community, but we weren't really welcome. I want to recall that it was the first year, I believe, probably the second semester, yeah, in the residence hall. The one girl that didn't want to stay with me, she ended up being able to move across the hall with another girl who made it either left or something happened. And I was on the phone one time, you know, you had hours. Your door had to be closed after a certain hour. But your door could be open before that, and then it would be study hall or study hours. And I was on the phone, and I accidentally dropped my phone, and the girl across the hall came flying out of the room. She said, you think just because you're a Negro, you're better than us? And I'm saying, wow, that's a twist. I never heard anything like that in my life. So, you know, we had all of those different kinds of issues that occurred. I was able to, while I was here, be the first African-American to be able to get involved in the Angel Flight Organization, which is a female auxiliary to the Air Force ROTC. Mm-hmm. I like the uniforms. So
they are nice.
I got a chance to do that. And it was a unique group of us who came here, because if you think about it, it was 1965, and I think that was about the year there were a lot of things starting to change around the country, period. My graduating senior class was more aggressive. We used to have to have a commencement in the auditorium, which was quite nice, but it was too small.
And all the kids, high school now.
Okay. And a lot of family could come, and it was really important for family to be able to come to these things. I grew up in a community that was primarily African-American, Mexicans, Puerto Ricans, Serbians, Jews, and those kinds of groups. And so it was kind of a melting pot.
Mm-hmm.
And when I came down here, I was so stunned. That's why I thought it was like, besides the cornfields and everything, the names that people would call people, I wasn't used to that. Because we were kind of close in high school, and I had not lived in an environment like that before. Ours was more what they call diverse today. Why did I tell you that? Where was it?
We're talking about the social things and the activities and the dances and things.
Oh, that's why. Because of that, the outgoingness and what have you. Like our graduating class, that's what I was going to tell you from high school. We decided that we were going to demand that our graduation be held in the gymnasium so that our families could be there, mm-hmm. and not just one or two, because it was so important for our community, which was, a still community, for their kids to be seen at graduation. And so we demanded that we be put in the gymnasium, and we were. Right. And this very, very, very popular newscaster out of Chicago, I believe his name was Jim Fahey. And older people will remember that name, okay, because he was really popular. We were able to get him to come and be a commencement speaker. I'm super shocked I'm remembering all of this detail. But because of that kind of assertiveness on our part, we weren't aggressive yet. We were assertive. When we came to school here, we felt that, you know, we should be able to participate in everything else that everybody else is participating in. So we tried to be involved in the social activities, and that wasn't terribly successful the first couple of years. We tried to be involved in other extracurricular activities. For example, I played clarinet in high school. I'd always wanted to play a saxophone, but because of in my opinion, the sexism, even in high school, they wouldn't let girls play the sax, so the next best thing was the clarinet, or the bass clarinet, no less, which I didn't like either one of them, but I liked being in the band. But I didn't own an instrument, and I joined the band down here. I didn't own an instrument, but I was able to get one. But this woman, and I'll never forget her in my whole life, her name was Maxine Lefevre, who was one of the band instructors. And she was so nasty to me that I just finally couldn't take it. And I went to quit, and one of the other band instructors, and I wish I could remember his name because I owe him credit for this, he said, just try to hang in there, ignore her, please ignore her. She'll be gone soon. And so I stuck it out a little while longer. But then it just kept the pressure, which is more and more because I didn't own an instrument and everybody else did. So I just said, I don't need this in my life. And yeah. I let it go after my sophomore year.
Okay. Then your career path, you stayed on after college. Well, tell us a little bit about
it. No, I actually didn't. In 69, I graduated.
Uh-huh.
And a goodly number of my incoming class that was still here graduated as well. Leroy, Roger Blalock, Ralph, Gail, all my buddies that I came in with, we all pretty much graduated at the same time, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And at that time, I was dating Roger, and he came here as a transfer student, so he didn't come here in the beginning with us. He came during our sophomore year from junior college to play basketball. And I had been dating him for a couple of years, and I was going to go and, I have to back up a little bit. In my sophomore year, I got really, really sick in college, and I was in a lot of pain. And one Sunday, because on Sundays we didn't have dinner, and so we'd go to the union to eat. And many of us used to try to hang around with the football and basketball players on Sunday because their food got paid for, and ours didn't. So they'd buy enough food to share it with us, which was great. This is why we had such strong bonding. And then, as part of my way to focus and relax, I used to go shoot pool. And so I'd be down there shooting pool. And then I came home after all of that Sunday evening thing, and I was, like, really in a lot of pain. They ended up taking me over to the emergency room at Push. And they did an x-ray and found that I had a stone in my kidney. So I had to go and get surgery for that. Well, when I graduated, I had to have surgery again because stones had formed again. When I graduated, I had been doing all the interviews like everybody else in the placement center, and I got offered a job at Procter & Gamble. And I was excited about that because my first boyfriend happened to be Herman Gilliam. Herman got drafted by the Cincinnati Royals, and Herman and I have been talking about getting back together, and it just so happens I get hired by Procter & Gamble
in Cincinnati.
So, okay, we're not going to hurt anybody's feelings, and when we get to Cincinnati, we might consider reacquainting ourselves with each other. Nevertheless, I had to have a physical in order to take my job. I'd been offered a job, I had the salary offer and the whole 9,000 yards. I'd been given a place where I was going to stay because the job entailed consumer research, which meant I'd be traveling most of the time. And so they had apartments that were established for people in positions like that since they were on the road a lot. I took my physical and they found that I had more stones. And so I ended up having the whole kidney removed because the scar tissue had grown all over everywhere. And so they told me I couldn't come to work. And so I was devastated. I was truly devastated. I said, I was in college. I got a degree. I had a job offer. Now I'm back where I started. Anyway, I was pretty close to Roger. And so we finally decided to get married. And then left and went to Detroit because he got offered a position by Dow Chemical as the sales. And because they were short on their salespeople, he didn't go directly to training at Midland. And they put us in the Detroit office because they were really desperate for salespeople in their plastic area. So we were there for 2 years. And he'd always wanted to be back here in coaching and had been keeping in contact. And he was invited back for a position in financial aid, and so we came back. While we were in Detroit, I worked for an agency called Family Services. And so I was doing something that was around in the area of my background of sociology, where, you know, you worked with people in the community, families and children, what have you. We came back here and I tried to get a position in Family Services here. They didn't have anything. And there just wasn't much of anything going on. And then that was about the time that they had started. You have to remember in 68, I think it was, 67, 68 was when all the Vietnam stuff was going on, and then all of the other civil rights movement stuff was going on, and our class was the ones that started the things that happened here at Purdue, where we did that little walk to the, from the Union. This was in 67. I always mix it up whether it's 67 or 68. But we, it was in the spring, I know that much, where we had been meeting, and we all got a little red brick and put it in a brown paper bag. Those were our instructions, and we met at, assembled at Stewart Center and marched to Hubdy Hall, and each one took a brick out of the bag and put it on the steps one at a time. And then our leaders took the little sign and put it in the middle and said, "The Fire Next Time." That was the name of a book by Baldwin. And then our small delegation of people went up and met with the dean of students and other representatives to talk about what our demands were. We were nonviolent, you know. We were so mild, we would never get in the news. But what we did was good because we did have some very comprehensive list of things that we wanted changed, like having black history courses. And that's why we have them now at Purdue, because we didn't have them.
Sure.
That's why we have a black cultural center now. That's why we have more black faculty and staff, which we really never had a lot of. Mm-hmm. We always would have one or two, and they'd last one year and be gone. So we never. But anyway, I've diverted all over the place. I'm sorry.
What I need to do, which I forgot, I'm going to interject this. Where the interview was conducted with Marion Blalock for the Purdue University Oral History Program. It took place on Friday, June 1, 2007, at her home. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the Oral History Librarian.
Could I offer you some water or coffee or something?
That's
so
cold.
Okay.
Unless you
so
want to
stop,
you okay? So now are you back at Purdue? So then
I left for 2 years, yes,
yeah.
And then we came back to Purdue.
Then
I couldn't get that job.
The,
and because of all of those initial efforts during the time when all the stuff was going on around the country with regard to civil rights and the Vietnam War and what have you, lots of new opportunities had developed. And then I was offered a,
According to what I said, you were a counselor in 73 in the Dean of Lynn's office, and then you were assistant dean of students in 74?
Before then.
Oh, okay.
I'm saying I ended up going to grad school.
Oh.
Something
okay.
I never wanted to do. I didn't like school that well. Okay, and I never planned to ever go back again. But because I couldn't find a job that I thought was something that would be
sure.
of interest to me, I was offered, I forget what they used to call those things they used to offer grad students. And I was very fortunate because they didn't usually give them to master's level. They usually
was it like an assistantship? Or?
They called it something like that.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay.
And so I went ahead and enrolled in the Department of Education for Counseling and Personnel Services
mm-hmm.
and did my master's work there. And then when I graduated, there was nothing in the Dean of Men's office.
Mm, okay.
And there was nobody in the Dean of Women's office. And I applied for the one in the Dean of Women's office, but they told me that they pretty much decided who they were going to get. So, jokingly, a friend of mine from grad school, go ahead and apply for the one in the Dean of Men's office, even though they were about through, too. And I just went ahead and did it. And they actually invited me in for an interview, and I actually got the job. So, it was
that's
the first
that
female.
That was still separate at that time,
mm-hmm.
wasn't both of them? Okay. I want to
so
put that further
I was
on the tape.
First full-time female that ever worked in the Dean of Men's office. That was in 1973.
Mm-hmm.
And then in 1974, the two offices merged.
Mm, okay.
And that, I stayed on. Initially, I was only supposed to be having the job for 1 year. But apparently, I did well enough that they decided that they'd let somebody else go. And unfortunately, I happened to be a black male, which didn't make things too nice for me in some parts of my community. But anyway, I was able to keep the job, and then they merged. And then that's when, what is that? Aunt. Sorry about that.
It's okay. It's down there. We got it.
Whatever.
Yeah.
Then around that time, the engineering, minority engineering effort had begun nationally.
Okay.
In around 1974. And, Dr. Amrine, Harold Amrine, who headed the...
He was in freshman engineering, right?
At that time, yeah.
Sure.
He had written this proposal, because we were part of this group called the Committee on Institutional Cooperation Plus Midwest Program for Minorities in Engineering, in short, CIC plus MPME. And there were a group of 10 schools plus one, and the Sloan Foundation had decided they wanted to take a very, very active financial part in this effort nationally. And so they gave the CIC MPMP this huge grant that each of the schools could compete for a portion of it. And Dr. Emrine and Sonny Taylor and Arthur Vaughn and Bill LeBeau, and I'm sure some other people were involved, put together this proposal and submitted it for bringing in 8th graders in the summer for summer engineering workshops. Anyway, about that time, Dr. Sonny Taylor was here as a visiting professor with her husband, who was here for a year or what have you. And so she had that job temporarily, and she convinced me to apply for it. And I said, but I like what I do, and I'd like to stay where I'm at. She came over here one Sunday and stayed all day long practically convincing me of why I needed to at least apply, take a look at it. So I said, okay, it won't kill me. And I did. And I ended up getting the job and I ended up taking it. I never left since then.
That's great.
So that's how I was in engineering. But I did start out as a counselor in the Dean of Men's office and continued on for a second year in that capacity until the two offices merged, and then I was a counselor in the Dean of Students office. And then I moved to freshman engineering. And
tell us a little bit about how you developed that program and what were some of the challenges.
Well, you know, I don't think that I developed the program. Some of the foundation for the program was already put there. And over the years, Dr. Emrine was extremely committed to the effort. And so it was very, very easy to work with him and to want to do good for him. And he allows you to be creative, and as a result, you know, working together as a team with him and the Bold and others over time, we began to add on to the program, and a lot of that addition came from grants that we were able to write for. All of our programming and scholarships were funded from outside funds. They were gift funds from industry, or proposal grants that we wrote for other agencies and what have you. And over time, you know, I guess my own ideology and philosophy crept into the thing. And people have always asked me, how do you do this program? Or how do you make this program successful? And I can never think of a better answer than to say, I follow the golden rule, do unto others as you'd have them do unto you. Every program that we would come up with, I think about what would I like and how would this impact me. And that was what was
the
driver.
That was the driver, right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And so we started out with that 8th grade summer workshop along with teachers. And then we started adding on, and then we came up with the teacher counselor separately. And then we came up with Mike had started the year before I came, because that was a program that had been operated out of not the National Academy of Engineers, but one of those engineering type deals. And so there were a number of schools around the country that was doing it. It initially started, Mike stands for Minority Introduction to Engineering, and that was...
Yes, I was going to tell you, a lot of these pre-college workshops you've been...
Rising high school seniors, and
sure.
So that was started by Arthur Bond and Sonny Taylor and Dr. Emrine and LeBold and others. And these programs were modeled after a program that started at the University of Illinois before they were taken on as a national operation. And so we had a 1 week, what was it, two 1 week programs those initial years.
Yeah, that MIT is one that's been going on for quite a while.
1975. And so my first experience with it was in 1976, because I took the job in freshman engineering in the fall of 1975. So my first experience was in 76. And it was also the first year that we brought in the 8th graders and the teachers and counselors for the two separate 1 week programs. Then over time, as different funds would make themselves available or different challenge opportunities were For example, the Department of Energy, I believe, came up with a grant that people around the country could apply for, and so we developed one for students in the 9th and 10th grade, and we call it Preface. And Mike, like I said, was already here. And then over time, we, that Sloan money ran out because it was 5 years. The Department of Energy money ran out because it was only like 2 or 3 years to begin with. And all of the funds had to be raised from gift funds from industry for the most part. And fortunately, Eastman Kodak kept the MITE program going. In the initial years of the MITE program, it was fully 100% paid for. The students paid zero. Zero. Kodak paid for the whole shebang, their transportation, their lodging, their meals, the educational materials we used, etc. But that soon ran out, and so we had to have
funds. Let me ask you this. What was your, since you're starting with the high school, you decided, your initial thing was to get started at the lower level and then work at the grade school up to get people recruited and interested in engineering.
The high school thing started before the Sloan Foundation grant came about, and so I don't know, that had to be a part of the, I wish I could remember it. I think it was the Committee on Institutional Cooperation. No. MITE started from something else. And it has to do with one of the national engineering organizations.
Sure.
And I just can't remember the name of it. But when I came on, we started with the 8th graders, the junior high school students, because of the Sloan grant and part of the CICMEMP program. And then we started building when the Department of Energy money came, then I could add the next group in. And what I would do with that is always leave the students that were there for the summer programs for the 8th grade, let them know that if you really enjoyed yourself, which they usually did, they just used, oh, can we stay longer, and can we come back next year? And, well, we couldn't use our funds like that. You know, we needed to broaden it out so that new students could get it. Well, being able to add that practice program on gave a carrot to say that if you do this, that, and the other in school, and you maintain such and such and such a GPA, et cetera, then you will have an opportunity to come to this next level of the program. Then after that program, when you are a rising high school senior, you'll be able to come to the MITE program. And so it became a systemic approach.
Great building block.
Exactly. And then we'd raise money for scholarships. And so as they come in for those who get admitted, then we had money to help them along. And then I'd hire them in positions and, you know, it was a systemic approach.
Right.
And you worked, it was a family. These are my children, you know?
Right.
We've got to raise them from here all the way.
Right.
And
yeah.
Then in, starting in around about 1994 or what have you, everything fell apart around the country. And at Purdue, too, the first thing that we did to help to destroy things that had been built over time here, because at one time we had close to 500 African-American, Mexican-American, Puerto Rican, and Native American Indian students enrolled in engineering. And I could give you the names and the bodies for each one of those individuals.
Wow.
I could account for every last one of them. And that peak year, I believe, was 1992, I think, was when we peaked. And then about 1994, the university decided to rip our buns, and they started this admissions application fee. And Dean Yang at the time was the only one that voted against it of all the deans. And they implemented it, and in the fall of 1995 or 96, because they implemented it in 95, so that fall, you could go back and look and you could see across the board the number of applications from those ethnic groups, four ethnic groups, plummeted all over the university. And I venture to say we've probably never recovered from that. That was the beginning of that end. But it got worse over time. The admissions office started coming up with all of these new creative things that they wanted to do.
All kinds of changes.
Yeah. It's depressing to talk about, so I need to skip on. Because I know what can be done, you know, and I know what has been undone. And I know that it fits with what's happened around the country. It's the gains that African Americans have made over 40 years or the last 30 years, they're almost all gone. All of that in my lifetime, where I went from being a Negro or a colored person to an Afro-American to an African-American to black to all of those things, you know? It's just so interesting to be
one of the
in this era.
Yeah, to see the changes you said earlier. One of the things you've been involved in is NSBE.
Well, yeah, after I started in 75, NSBE had had their, in that spring, they had brought those students from other schools around the country and Canada to meet to talk about starting a national organization. And in 1975, I just became one of the co-advisors. And I've just been with them ever since.
Can you tell, for the researchers, how did it actually get established here? They decided that since it started here that this would be the... This
no, there were a number of colleges that had a version.
Okay, a chapter. Okay.
Yeah, they called them different kinds of things.
Sure.
In fact, one of my really good friends, a retired colleague from Michigan, is still trying to dispute where the whole thing started.
Oh.
She wants to say it started in Michigan. And when I saw the email that had been going between her and Seal, that does the university function things in Virginia, I had to chuckle. I said, gosh, we've had this argument a long time ago. I thought it was over. So I'm not getting in the middle of that. Anyway, what happened was it started here. Ed Barnett, who is an alum and who's since deceased, was the first, I guess, leader of the chapter here. And
he was a student here. Okay.
In which area of Virginia? I think he was IE, but I'm not real sure. I can't remember. But anyway, he, I guess, kind of started the chapter here, which was just a group here. It was not a chapter. It was a group, another organization here.
Right.
And then as some of the younger folks like Tony Harris and George Smith and a group of the other ones that call themselves the Chicago Six came up. Tony Harris told me some time ago that he was very involved with the ME Student Society, and he'd gone to one of their conferences once, and he was so excited.
Does ME mean mechanical?
Yeah, mechanical.
Okay.
Sure. And he came back and he said, why can't we do the same thing with our Society of Black Engineers group and get students all around the country and start a national organization like that? And the woman that I mentioned to you before, Dr. Sonny Taylor, she and Art Bond and Dr. Arthur Hansen were extremely instrumental in getting them all the right contacts. I believe Dr. Hansen.
This is President Hansen? Okay.
Provided them with a list of all the presidents of these different universities that had large engineering schools, and I guess helped to make the contacts, I'm not sure. And so they had, in April of 1975, their first meeting of all these people, which they brought together, and they decided to start the National Society of Black Engineers. So that was in 1975.
Yeah, that's pretty good, yeah. You met a fac fellow? Were you a faculty fellow at any
time? From McCutcheon.
McCutcheon.
I haven't been in 1,000 years. I don't even remember what years it was.
We're still fac fellows over at Tarkington. You know, he's been there longer than I have, anyway. Mm-hmm. And then you did say, how did you get, what were some of your things when you were on the board of that St. Mary of the Woods? You were on the board of
that was interesting. I got a call from Dr. Bearing. Dr. Bearing, he was coming from some meeting, and he was calling from his cell phone in his car and said that he wanted to notify me that he had submitted my name as a potential trustee for the Board of Trustees at St. Mary of the Woods College, an all-female college in Terre Haute, Indiana. And I was like, whoa, first of all, to get a call from Dr. Bearing, and secondly, to be nominated to do such a thing. I was very excited about that. So I went for my initial interview, and I got accepted and ended up doing a three-term tenure. You could only go up to 9 years, and I did.
Three different terms, yeah.
So I hated driving to Terre Haute. I hated Terre Haute. But you get on that campus, and you just kind of fall in love. It was just something so serene and beautiful about it, and spiritual. And so I enjoyed that, and I enjoyed the people.
That was a nice thing. You also got the Beverly Stone Award in 1982 for that. That's any other special award that you recall?
I got the Howard Sleeman Award.
Okay.
And I got the A.A. Potter Award. Yeah, I got a bunch of national awards. I have to go back and look at my resume. And I got all these plaques and stuff. And I said, you know, in the future, just give you some money. I think these are dust plates or something. They're really nice. But I got all these things that once I get this crap out of my house and into that barn, I can start putting these things up on my walls.
Yeah, okay. Anything specific, any things as you look back, what's your favorite memory from Purdue? You got one? An outstanding event in your life? And another thing I sometimes ask people, is there any questions that I didn't ask that you'd like to share?
I've probably given you way more than you were expecting to get. In terms
this
of
is we're looking for the
details.
Researchers. This is fine, you know. As you reflect back.
No, because there were a series of really good things, you know, to come from the kind of environment, which was a loving environment, don't misunderstand me. I didn't know I was poor until I came here and people told me I was poor, okay? Or actually, I kind of did because, you know, I had different relatives had different things that had happened in their lives, and one of my most favorite and one who really, really has stuck by me all these years, and she just turned 89 the other week. She really used to make a lot of clothes for me. She did all kinds of wonderful things for me, instilled a lot of values, and she was one of the extended family that was real primary in my life. And I say that to say that coming here was one of the most memorable experiences, surviving it.
Okay. And the students.
Mm-hmm. And graduating and then coming and working here, and then getting some of the highest awards you could get here at the institution, and being able to make a contribution and actually know human beings whose lives that I was able to impact, be a part of impacting. That's not a memorable experience.
Right, because this is what you, these are what you look back on, and this is what you made an impact.
And that goes back to the golden rule, do unto others as you'd have them do unto you, and it also always makes me remember that we're each here on this earth for a very specific reason, and for me to be the only one to survive my nuclear family and with all of the major health issues and surgeries that I've had, and to still be able to do the things that I've done to help other people.
Yeah.
And Purdue played a major role in that.
Right. And you've got and you're known nationally too, and you've made a lot of contacts within the community as well as outside.
Yeah, that's why I try to stay by myself a lot right now. I need peace and quiet. No, that's not true. But it is different, and it took some adjustment the first year. Not being there and being overwhelmed as usual, or staying very, very late hours and all that. But I'm used to it now, I think.
Whatever. Okay. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
My pleasure.